I'm going to just take about 30 seconds just for context. If people don't know DARPA, basically we invite about 100 people who are at the very top of their game, who want to come and actually want to give something back to make the world a better, safer, or more secure place. You just come for 4 years. You usually run one or two programs. They're usually somewhere in the $50 to $70 million range. So that's what you'll see. Chris, who I'm going to introduce, is sort of the perfect example of that. Chris, a little while ago, was at a human trafficking conference and heard that the average cost of procuring a female is $90. And I think if you hear something that's shocking and you have a technical ability to do something about it, you have a moral obligation to go forward and do something and fix it. And so Chris went around and he saw what law enforcement does and what victims outreach group do, and they use commercial search engines, and you realize that stuff simply won't scale. And so what Chris is going to show you is some very early work we're doing to sort of rethink search and do some new things. As you watch it, the two things I'd ask you to think about, one is, are there things you can do to make the program better? Feel free. We'll release it all as open source so you can have it and play with it. And two is, even though we'll talk mainly about human trafficking, obviously it can move into other domains. And so if those domains are interesting to you, feel free to take it and move into that. And with that, Chris.
Great. Thanks, Dan.
Yep.
As Dan mentioned, we like to end trafficking, but first we need to understand it, which is a challenge, for example, in sex trafficking, because it's enmeshed in the online world of advertisements for sex and massage. And so we need something beyond search, something more like analysis. And so with a trigger warning for sensitive content, we'll start the way that many investigators do, with a lead. In this case, an email address. They go to open source tools like Google. They search, and they do what everyone does. They click on the first link. In this case, the link shows a map. It shows some blue bars. Maybe that's not what they're looking for. They go back. Now they search on click on the next link. In this case, it's a bit surprising. There's a lot of character issues. There's lists of places and lots of images. And again, maybe not what they're interested in. So they go back and try a third time, because third time's the charm when searching. And in this case, the page is more structured. Maybe they understand what they're looking at. And in this case, that they see a phone number. And so like investigators do, they pivot from email addresses to phone numbers and use the web search engines to provide sort of corroborating content to build investigations for subpoenas and so on. Over and over again, searching and clicking and reading and searching and clicking and reading and then cutting and pasting. This is the standard procedure for the use of web scale information to support law enforcement and victim outreach. And so the first thing we'll do is use computers to help us address this. What you'll see here is we call the browse path. These five nodes are the exact five nodes that you just saw in that video. The first one was the search bar we went to a page over here and came back. In the end, there's five pages. But quickly, what we'll do is depart into the sort of peripheral content that gets created. We call this the data wake because here, as you see, there are six or five purple nodes, where the five nodes are the same browse path we just saw. But what are connected to those nodes are all of the web pages that we didn't click on. We call this the sort of wake of content, which is created as you trail into the internet. And this is content that would be followed if there was enough time, or if we were comprehensive, or if we were better. For example, on this page, there were a few dozen links that we could have clicked on. And we call this the frontier of the investigation that we'd like to better understand in terms of its relevance to sort of what we're trying to do. The other way we can redraw this browse path is with shared content. So these big blue nodes are the same five from the video you saw. Here we've connected them if they share a phone number across two different web pages. For example, this phone number was on both this web page as well as this web page. And although I'm sure you were watching the video closely, I doubt you noticed that there was one phone number that appeared on all five web pages. So those really easy for computers to determine exact matches and comparisons of content, really hard for people, especially when the content is rich on very long web pages. And so now we started with an email address, we pivoted to a phone number, and now we've found this new phone number which connects all of these pages we saw. As an investigator, we may want to understand where else this is happening. And so what we can do in the background is we can crawl all of the online space for ads for sex and massage and see, in fact, how often does this kind of number occur? And we did that, and it turns out it occurs over 100 times. Sometimes with the email address of interest, sometimes not. And in fact, what we found, we've observed over 30 million ads for sex online. We estimate that's about $250 million just to pay for posting the ads. much less for the collection of money for services rendered. And so there's a real scale issue with the size of the web and the places where these things are being posted. And so we'd like to understand, for example, statistical properties, like, is this normal? You know, how abnormal is this? These are all in LA, for example. Is this an odd thing for LA? And so what we did was build simple models for different locations, and we stratified by three things. One was local, seen the ad before, seen it again. One is new to town, saw the ad or the person elsewhere, now we see them in LA, for example. Or first seen, first time we've seen a new potential victim. And we did that for LA, for example, and we found that although the number of ads was not unusually large, that there was a lot that were coming in. Here, the example, the blue lines are ads that were in LA, and now we're seeing them elsewhere, like in Minnesota. And the yellow lines are ads we saw elsewhere, now we're seeing NLA. So there's a lot of movement of women and ads and people that are surrounding this online space for the sale of sex and massage. And so we'd like to understand different ways to get at the information, for example, like a map. And so we'll have a splash page here, which is just a map with bubbles that detail volume of ads for sex that we've seen in those places. It's a global phenomenon, so we'll sort of just zoom into a different part of the world. You can see that these things happen in India, they happen in Europe, and we'll take an example in London. For example, London, during this time period of September to June, there were 9,000 ads from this particular provider in the London area. We'd like to maybe understand, again, this sort of geographic movement of people and this sort of potential to understand how that can be used to thwart trafficking in the first place. We'll take a closer look at London by clustering these ads. We'll cluster them and then look for other locations. And here, for example, we'll take Dubai. So of those 9,000 ads, we clustered them. There were six clusters that also mentioned Dubai. We'll take a closer look at one of those clusters that has 67 ads to try to understand why is their ad in London mentioning Dubai and how can we address it. In this case, for example, if we look at the kind of cluster, we see that there's one phone number that connects all 67 of those ads in London, and we may want to understand where else those ads are occurring. And here we can see from this list of places, it's not just Dubai, it's also Quebec and Budapest and Prague and Hartford, Connecticut and Zurich. And we may ask ourselves, why are all of these ads appearing in all these places referring to London, and they all appear all around October, so we can just take a look at some of them and see. And in this case, if we just grab one, for example, we can see, although it's hard to read from that distance, that it's a recruitment ad. It's a recruitment ad for very high-end escorts for a service in Dubai that was posted in 24 countries all at the same time. And if we look at those same places later, we can see new women appearing. We can see, hi, I'm Celeste, I'm new to town, I came in from Dubai, and we can understand how these organizations are structuring both the recruitment and exploitation of people sort of worldwide. And we wanted, sort of, in terms of like lessons we've learned, one, you know, I mentioned before this 30 million observed ads is the volume of the problem. The second is ones like this, the connectedness of locations and people and movement. And the third was connection to other sort of bad things that we've seen. So we take an example like this, and we'll take a different place, a place in the US, and we'll look at sort of this kind of graph diagram of ads for sex that we see in this city in the US that are connected by things like phone numbers and email addresses. We took a random sort of snapshot of one area with 600 examples, and we threw them over the fence to our law enforcement partners and said, have you ever seen any of these individuals and numbers associated with any other known crimes? And with 600 numbers, we expected, you know, one or two or three known other crimes connected to trafficking, but it turns out that of the 600 numbers, 466 of them posted in current ads for sex have been associated with historically other crimes like murder and child abuse and kidnapping, and that's a pretty extremely large proportion. And in addition, we found that those same 600 numbers were associated with several hundred thousand dollars of financial transactions in sub-10K increments to the border regions of North Korea, both on the north side and the south side, which are a strong indication that there are connections between women being moved out of North Korea through China and South Korea into the US and sort of money being paid back. And so that's sort of the third lesson, is this connectedness to other badness. And so what we like to do through this kind of approach is to allow for lots of different entry points into the discovery of content, the extraction of useful and relevant information, like entities and relationships and locations. We like to allow for an interface which is used for analysis, not just for search and retrieval, because we think that as a broad class, we need to have the ability to excise the subset of the internet relevant to a particular domain and allow for the analysis of it to support things like victim outreach, law enforcement, and sort of criminal investigations. And to that end, what we've done is begun three concurrent pilots with the National Trafficking Hotline, with the New York Manhattan Special Victims Bureau, and with the New Jersey State Police, so that we understand from the different vantage points ways in which they can use technology to understand content on the web, whether it's deep or dark or hard to get at, in order to combat major sort of issues like human trafficking. And so what the future looks like are technologies that allow us to prioritize these investigations. If we go back to this data wake with the peripheral content, we can see all of these websites are ones that an investigator coming back to their station could visit, but we don't know which ones are the ones to follow. And so what we can do is crawl them in advance and compare them to sort of enterprise content on a database that says which ones might be relevant, and in this case are these things like phone numbers, and we can sort of rank them. And so of these 50 potential leads they could follow, we see that two of them have one piece of information already of relevance, and two of them have two pieces. And so that guides our sort of pathway forward. And if then we also want to, for example, work with our partners, we can start to add the ability to compare what each of us have seen. So here we just redraw based on user, where the big nodes are users and the small nodes are web pages. And we see that in some cases they visited similar spaces and in some cases different ones. And this is very early days from the standpoint of online multi-person collaboration for investigation and analysis of this kind of content. So we need your help and we need your input on some of these issues. So thank you.